Yeah.
Good morning, guys. Yes, I'm still on my mom. I just woke up. I'm gonna get up in a few minutes. Get dressed. I ate breakfast. I took the dog out, so I'm gonna get dressed. Take my meds. And brush my teeth. Today will be a good day, just like yesterday. Even though the day before was a good day, but I got stood up on a date. Like, I was supposed to go on a date with this guy, and I got stood up. But you know what? It's okay. It's his loss. So all I can say, hey guys. So today I'm going to be reading chapter 2 of The Mommy Wish by Pamela Brown. Browning. Eric rose from his berth in the bow of Fiona early the next morning, before the fog had cleared, from the sound checking on his sleeping daughter, before brewing coffee as strong as he could make it. Her Majesty Molly K. McBride was sleeping in, no doubt, he thought wearily, and after a glance at the closed door to the master stateroom, it was probably just as well since he had a checklist a yard long that needed attention before they could cast off. He took his coffee up on deck and watched the sun. Sunrise was a pretty sight, one that never failed to please him. That business about Phoebe last night and the fury in Molly's eyes when she all but accused him of being a father who shrieked his duty, it was so unfair. He loved Phoebe wholeheartedly, more than he loved anyone else in the world. Who was Molly K. McBride to criticize him? She was a spoiled brat, heir to the McBride millions, diligent. The Delonte, who was free to leave her cushy job in the family manufacturing business for however long it took to ferry her grandfather's yacht to Fort Lauderdale. She couldn't understand what it would be like to walk a mile in his well-worn dock sliders. He should have informed Emmett McBride that he'd find his own first mate, thank you very much. He could have called his friend Tom, who in the past had often left his insurance business on the spur of the moment to go sailing, or his brother Lars, who needed a vacation from his family once in a while. But would either of those options have worked? Tom's expanding business sapped most of his energy these days, and Lars' wife was expecting a baby. Maybe there was no one to call, no one he could rely on, only himself. Dad, I'm up, said Phoebe, scrambling up the ladder. She captured herself into his arms, almost spilling his coffee. Wait a minute, he said, setting his mug down carefully in the cup holder beside the ship wheel. He wrapped his arm around his daughter, inhaling the fresh, just woke up scent of her. She pulled away. You didn't come home until late last night, she said. It took me a long time to get the bolt, she explained. It seemed as if he was always explaining something to Phoebe. Always trying to excuse himself. I waited and waited, but I couldn't stay awake. Are we leaving here today? Yes, as soon as I finished my coffee. Her face circled. I was just going to know. She's just getting to know Miss Knowles, the lady in the office. She makes really good oatmeal cookies and has... She has a cat. Boots, she's going to have kittens. Boots is a she, Phoebe. She's going to have kittens. I won't get to see them, Phoebe said, disappointed at... evident in her tone. Eric didn't know what to say about that. Well, one nice thing is that Molly is going away, she said. She said so, Phoebe said, perking up a bit. That's right. He drained the last bit of coffee and stood up. Okay, kiddo, I set your Cocoa Krispies out in a bowl in the galley. You better eat before we get underway. I'll come up to eat with you, Phoebe said, climbing down the ladder. Things might have been different by this time if he hadn't taken his job. Eric reflected as he proceeded through his checklist of things to do. Much as he liked Emmett McBride, Eric had wanted the task of sailing this big boat to Fort Lauderdale, so he bonded with the old guy Derry and his visit to Sarham Marina. And when Emmett had invited him to live aboard when he had to return home to Maine, Eric had accepted his offer. He figured that he'd feel good about helping Emmett out. And at the time, he and TV were staying on a caravan whose owner had suddenly shown up and decided to go cruising to the Bahamas. And so here they were, living on the field. Eric had meant his occupancy of Emmett's boat to be temporary before moving on to Thunderbolt, Georgia, where Steve, a buddy from his Navy days, had invited him to work on a shrimp trawler. It sounded like a good deal. He and Phoebe could live in a camper trailer on Steve's property. Phoebe would be able to play with Steve and George's three kids, and maybe be less lonely. Maybe quit playing with pretend vacuum cleaners for Pete's sake. He heard doors open and closing below and turned around expecting to see Phoebe. Good morning. Damn. If it wasn't clean, Molly McBride. Her hair is as shiny as new copper pennies, her complexion all rosy from sleep. She peered up the companionway. In the salon below, she was wearing a robe that from his angle showed exactly the right amount of cleavage to whet his interest. Good morning, he said. Help yourself to some coffee. You can fry yourself an egg if you want. Okay, then I want to take a look at the chart. Go ahead. Eric wished that Molly had stayed in bed. Her presence on the deck wouldn't be required until just before they actually left the dock, so she doubted that she would be much help even then. She didn't appear strong enough to haul on a sail, not that it would be necessary. Fiona had motorized the winches. Eric doubted she knew much about navigation either. That's okay. That was okay. She could handle it. It would be best if she'd limit her help for throwing a line now and then and confine her main attention to babysitting Phoebe. He'd feel better if two adults were keeping tabs on his daughter when they were underway. Phoebe came up, balancing the table carefully. Guess what, Dad? Molly likes oatmeal. I told her to try to cook with turkeys, but she only said yes. She offered to fix me an egg. I didn't want one, though. I'll cook eggs for you anytime you want, Eric told her. Something about Phoebe was different, but he couldn't figure out what it was. Still thinking about it, he made his way to the foredeck. He studied the horizon. The sound was calm today, and the wind was steady. Perhaps they could reach Trent's Cove by evening. Phoebe had almost finished the cereal when he went back into the cockpit. Molly gave me a headband to wear. She said she doesn't need it. She said I can keep it. Did you say thank you? Sure, I always say thank you. Do you like it? Phoebe's bangs, which usually trimmed with nail scissors, were neatly smooth under some sort of elastic. Maybe you should get a couple of those. What did you call it? A headband. Can I get a red one? Of course. Good. I like Molly, Dad. She read me a story last night. Me and my vacuum cleaner. Phoebe had a couple of tattered children's books, and she carted everywhere they went. She'd always meant to get her some new ones, but there usually wasn't much room in their borrowed quarters. Great, he said, without much enthusiasm. He wondered what story it had been. He wondered where you bought headbands. Molly sewed a button on my shirt, too. I think she should stay with us all the time, don't you? I don't believe that's possible, he said, frowning. If she wanted to stay, he'd let her, right? This had gone far enough. Phoebe, there are some things you need to understand, he said firmly. At the moment, Molly came up to the companionway and stepped into the cockpit. She's wearing a pair of khakis and a snug, long-sleeved navy blue t-shirt. And behind her, the newly risen sub set her red gold hair on fire. After his first glance, he forced himself to look away from her breast, thinking that she had big sails for such a small ship. As for the rest of her, well, he preferred a woman to have big breasts and narrow hips. Said woman has to have a perky derriere, and Molly came to cry, didn't disappoint. Dad, what were you saying? I see. Never mind. Time to be on our way. We have to get fuel first, he said, making himself focus on the task at hand, which wasn't easy considering that this woman was gorgeous. Molly looked down, her sweet, upturned nose at him. Fine, I'll handle the bowline if you like. That's good, Phoebe. You stay where you are, okay? Can I go below? It's cold up here. Sure. Phoebe departed, and Aaron jumped across to the dock and pulled the line off its cleat, then tossed it to Molly before unwinding the line at the stern. By the time he was back on Fiona, Molly was efficiently coiling the bowline and tumbled the curls hiding her face. It was an exceptional face, he thought, with high cheekbones and none of the freckles he associated with redhead. The engine started about right away. Molly stood beside him at the wheel, watching as the space between boat and dock widened. She had the greenest eyes he'd ever seen, greener than the shallows near the shore, greener than the sky when rain was on the wing. He wanted to ask her if she wore tinted contact lenses, then realized that the color was natural. Emmett's eyes, though clouded now with age, were almost the same shade. "We're going outside, I take it," she asked. "Going outside" meant that they'd be heading out into the ocean instead of staring inside the protected waters of the intercoastal waterway. He nodded. "I wanted to avoid using the engine as much as possible. We'll motor out of the marina, then raise the sails." "You didn't get the engine repaired?" "Oh, I did. I gobble up expensive diesel fuel if you don't have to, that's all." He didn't add that he was worried about the temperamental fuel injector pump, which he hadn't been able to replace before. Molly didn't question his judgment. She only smiled, and in that smile was a whole world of enthusiasm. "It looked like a great day for sailing. I'll be glad when we can cut the engine and let the wind take her away," she said. But at the moment, he wasn't thinking about sailing. He was thinking about something else altogether, which was the lack of enthusiasm in his own life. He knew plenty about picking up and going on after a tragedy, but what he hadn't been able to do was regain his joy and simple things. Sometimes merely getting up in the morning and putting one foot in front of the other seemed like too much trouble, yet he did it, mostly for Phoebe's sake. His love for his daughter sustained him, but no matter how hard he tried, he hadn't felt even one moment of true happiness since Heather died. He felt pleasure. He felt satisfaction in jobs well done. That was about it. In that moment, Eric wanted, with all his heart, to be able to look forward to something that almost as quickly he discarded that possibility. It wouldn't happen. It couldn't happen. At least it hadn't so far. Under sail, they were able to achieve a speed of 6 knots with calm seas and cooperative winds. Fiona made Trench's Cove by dusk, and they anchored around the point within sight of a desolate shore. By that time, Eric was willing to admit, however grudgingly, that Queen Molly Kate McBride was a pretty good sailor. She knew port from starboard, and she didn't mind work. She knew when to pull in the mainsail and when to let it out. She understood when to tack and when to jive. The main problem was that she didn't like to follow orders. "It's not what you're asking me to do. It's your tone of voice," she'd informed him haughtily when he told her to go below and check their headings. He didn't have much to say about that. He could have retorted that he didn't always have time to ask politely, but no. When captaining a boat, he needed instant action from the crew in order to avoid mishaps. He could have reminded her that Emma was paying him to be the captain of Fiona, and that she had been foisted upon him as his first mate. He didn't say any of this, mostly because Molly's cheeks had been blazing with indignation, and he liked the way she looked with green fire sparking in her eyes. Now he made sure that the anchor was firmly seated so that the boat wouldn't drift, and after that, he followed Molly below and suggested she cook their dinner. This seemed like a perfectly reasonable request. Emma left plenty of food stored behind the lounge of the Nissewa. He told her he was unprepared for Molly to perch her hands on her hips and regard him with the disdain that she lightly reserved for an invading army of cockroaches. "Let me get this straight, Eric. You expect me to cook dinner, and that would be every night now?" She asked, her chin tilting up a notch. When she spoke, she had bound her hair, that riotous hair back with a dark ribbon in his fingers inch to untie it. He was sorely tempted to make the end of the ribbon and watch her hair tumble around his shoulders, clenching his hands into fists at his side and stared back at her in the dim glow from the light fixture, saying you love the dining table. I thought you'd want to cook, he said, since I'm not very good at it, as Phoebe has mentioned. Molly tipped her head back so that she was gazing into his eyes. What makes you think I'm any better at cooking than you are? This set him back a tad. He gazed out the porthole for a moment. Noted that it was almost there. I assume he stammered, feeling like a fool. Grilled cheese sandwiches are the extent of my cooking skills, he informed her, except for eggs and maybe a decent stew. He stared at her. We're in trouble then. Don't you cook for yourself at home? Rarely if it comes to that. I usually open a can of soup. He supposed he should have realized that Queen Molly wasn't in the habit of looking after herself. All right, let's break out our supplies. We'll collaborate on meals, okay? Just trying to build a little team spirit here, okay? He thought, just trying to get along. Going along to get along must have been in her mind, too, because she managed a tentative grin. All right, she said. Phoebe, listening to this conversation, said, why can't we have grilled cheese sandwiches again? Variety is the spice of life, my girl, Eric said, peeking her nose as she pulled the cushions out of the lounge to close the doors of the cabinets behind. He yanked one open and tossed a can to Molly, who caught it. Big bean, she said. Here's another. She thought it too. Vienna sausages. Let's open a couple more of those. How about some corn? He dug a can of Mexican corn out of a corner. I like Vienna sausages, Phoebe said, her eyes bright. And can I have the baked bean jar? What for? He asked. Are my messages in a bottle, Phoebe asked. What? Said Molly. She puts messages in a bottle and throws them overboard. It's harmless enough. I'll wash out the jar for you, Molly told Phoebe. After a moment's hesitation, Molly opened the beans and sausages, and he took charge of the corn. Phoebe arranged the sausages in a microwavable dish, and he and Molly shared the cramped space in front of the stove. While everything heated up, the deepening darkness outside lay about Fiona like soft velvet. The fact that they were all alone in the cold made them seem encapsulated in the warmth and light of the boat. It was easy when you were in the situation to forget that there was a world out there, that somewhere people were driving home from work, picking up the kids at daycare, planning an evening's entertainment. Phoebe, after consigning Havana sausages to the microwave oven, took the clean glass jar into a small chart room adjacent to the galley, where she sat and sat on drawing yet another picture of a vacuum cleaner. Molly seemed focused on her cooking chores, and every once in a while, the motion of the boat rocking on the waves lured him closer to her. She ignored him pointedly, but as they continued to work together to prepare the meal, he sensed a shift in her awareness. As the rocking of the boat grew stronger, he realized it was inevitable that they would eventually bump into each other. Sure enough, that happened in great rapid succession. He said, excuse me, at each occurrence. The first time she replied, that's okay, and the second time she colored slightly. He knew that was because their tips touched, or more accurately, her backside brushed the side of his thigh. It was something he didn't mind one bit. After they heated up their simple meal, Phoebe pushed her drawing aside and insisted on sitting between them at the small oval table, keeping up a stream of chatter so that he and Molly didn't have to talk. Treating himself to several convert glasses while Molly was paying attention to something else. From what he could tell, under that shirt, she had rock solid abs, long legs, long feet, a good thing for high arched and tail, adept at both walking and dancing. He'd like to get her on the dance floor sometime. Ha, said Chance. Molly was barely tolerating him, though. She warmed up a bit last night when she confronted him about his shortcomings as a parent. How long would it take them to get Fiona to Fort Lauderdale if he would stick it out? He'd be a few thousand dollars ahead, and he needed the money. If he was ever to buy Fiona the house she wanted in a community suitable for bringing up children, none of which he cared to tell Molly, who sat across from him and carried on an animated conversation with Fiona. His daughter's hair turned, tamed by the headband, looked better than it had in a long time. He had to admit that Molly had quickly wrought miracles in Phoebe's appearance. they made short work of the dinner. Not bad, he said, pushing back from the table after he finished eating. We can do better, Molly said, though. He knows she didn't know her. Well, see, Aaron made some people really hungry, and the hungry person wasn't really particular. I'll clean up, Molly said, after we all carried their dishes to the sink, and Phoebe had trotted off to the bath. He figured Molly was volunteering to clean the baby so that they wouldn't have to tangle around each other again in the galley. On a note of regret, he said, suit yourself. It came out sounding gruff and ungrateful, though that wasn't how she felt at all. She merely shrugged. Hand me the salt and pepper was all she said. She stowed them in their proper place behind it, ran on the galley, where they wouldn't slide across the cabin tomorrow when they were underway. Guess I'll check the engine, he said, stretching a lever, and she kept her eyes averted, rinsing the dishes. Right, she said. He went into the engine room and decided that the engine was holding up well. If only the blame thing would get down to Fort Lauderdale, he'd celebrate. Phoebe came out of the forward bathroom. She was all clean and sweet smelling from her bath and was wearing a warm cotton robe over her pajamas. Dad, let's take the cushions from the cockpit and lie down on the aft deck to look at the stars, she said. After I throw my message in the bottle overboard, I mean, lying on the deck is what he and Phoebe did on many nights. He glanced at Molly as she was being. Well, that sounds like fun, she said. While he and Phoebe co-signed her latest message bottle to the waves, Molly tossed pillows from the cockpit to the deck. What's this message about, Pina? He asked, but she only grinned seriously. Once the bottle had floated away on the tide, Phoebe flopped down, spread eagle on her cushions, and stared upward, and Molly, pulling a sweatshirt over her head, came on deck to join them. The sky overhead was spangled with stars, trying to outshine the moon, and there wasn't a cloud in sight. Fiona rode easily on gentle waves. The air smelled of mist and marshes and places far away. I see the Milky Way, Phoebe said gleefully. I see the Big Dipper. Point out the Little Dipper, Eric said as Molly settled down beside him, arranging her cushions to her liking. It's right there. How about Pegasus? There he is, Phoebe said, and as an aside to Molly, he's a flying horse. Phoebe, you're impressive, Molly said. I bet most kids wouldn't be familiar with so many constellations. My dad taught me, she said, and Eric curved an arm around. He was proud of his daughter, of her considerable capability. She was as smart as they come, he was sure of that. He'd been homeschooling her for the past year and a half. Can you find the Pleiades, he prompted? Over there, they're stars, but they're called the Seven Sisters. I wish I had a sister, Phoebe yawned. Her voice kept getting sleepier and sleepier. If you stay up until morning, you can see Jupiter, the biggest planet you can see. Oh, I don't know. Lots and lots. My mommy's up there, too. She's one of the brightest stars in heaven. Her words drove off, and when Eric glanced down at her a few moments later, Phoebe's eyes were closed. She had fallen asleep. He wasn't sure what Molly had made of Phoebe's last statement. Once Phoebe had asked him what the stars were made of, and he told her that they were the souls of people who had died. She had wanted to know which one was her mother, and he pointed out Vega, one of the brightest stars in the sky. Now he saw that Molly had turned her head and was looking at him inquiringly, and he thought that some explanation was possible. He cleared her throat. I told Phoebe that thing about her mom, he said. It's beautiful, Molly said quietly. I think so, he said. It was easier than well, just easier. Ever since she accepted that her mother was a star in the sky, that she could see almost every night, Phoebe had been much less likely to ask him when Heather was coming back. Well, you did what you could in difficult situations. That was all. He listened to a distant boat motor, to the wind singing and rigging. Out of the corner of his eye, he could see that Molly seemed pensive, and he wondered what she thought about, probably what all career-minded women thought about themselves, or at least that had been his experience in the old days before he opted out of the corporate world. What time do you want to leave in the morning? Molly asked after a while. About the same time as today, he told her. She didn't speak again, and when he turned toward her, he saw that her eyes, too, were closed. Her features were cast in silver by the starlight, gentle and repose. He wondered what would happen if he reached out and took a finger across her lips and continued up toward her brow. her brow, threaded his fingers through that abundant mass of hair, spilled across the cushion like rumpled silk. Was her eyes open in surprise? Did she cry out? Would she sit up and run below? He was tempted to try it, but only for a moment. What was he thinking? He needed to clear his head. Put a halt to wanting something that would never happen. She let him know that she didn't think much of him. Moodily, he turned his eyes back toward the heavens. He saw Vega now, glimmering and shimmering, a brilliant blue white. And for a moment, he wished that it were true, that it really was Heather up there looking down on them, shedding light on everything. Molly stared beside him, making little purring noises like a kitten. She opened her eyes, stared blankly at him for several seconds, then sat up with abruptness. What time is it? I almost fell asleep. About 9 o'clock. Time for bed, she yawned and stretched. You need my help getting people below? He shook his head. I'll carry it. I've done it before. Molly hesitated. She's a darling girl, she said. She is, isn't she? Thanks for saying so. You're lucky to have her. He gazed fondly down at Phoebe, whose chest was rising and falling with each breath. I know. For a moment, it seemed as if Molly were going to say something else, but she must have felt better of it. Good night was all she said, and then she was picking her way across the deck, avoiding the open hatches of the cabin below, reaching for the rigging so she wouldn't fall if the boat lurched. The breeze ruffled her hair and whipped her shirt and pants tight against her body, divinitating every curve. Come on, Tina, he murmured to Phoebe. He mumbled something and slid her arms around his neck. He didn't carry her downstairs until he was sure that Molly had retired to her stateroom. He didn't want to have to press past Queen Molly in the dim light of the cabin, maybe coming too close, perhaps touching her without meaning to. If he had occasion to touch Molly King's bride again during this voyage, he was pretty damn sure he would do it. Phoebe didn't resist when he sucked her tightly into her bunk. When he went to his own V-berth in the bow of the ship, he punched his pillows every which way, but he couldn't get comfortable. Finally, he opened the hatch above him so that he could see Vega, and he had chosen this particular star to be Heather's, given the way it sparkled so blue was fitting. Blue had been Heather's favorite color. Eric had almost dozed off when he heard the music from the aft stateroom. Heart music soft and sweet, played Molly's Irish harp, and she could play it very well. It sounded like the music of the ages. He relaxed completely with that music echoing in his ears, imagining how Molly must look while playing her harp. She'd be sitting on a low bench beside the big bed in the master stateroom, the harp in her lap, spilling across her lovely features. She'd be smiling gently. He'd be sprawled across the bed, perhaps fingering a silken sash that she wore around her waist. Every once in a while, she'd glance over at him, a warm, teasing light in her eyes. He smiled back, and unfortunately, he realized in the last few moments before he fell asleep, this was only fantasy. There was no room for him in this picture, none, and he'd better stop imagining that there was. Message in a bottle. To whom it may concern, she's here, my new mommy, at least I'm wishing that she'll be my new mom. She didn't mind my vacuum cleaner, and she made a good grilled cheese sandwich. Love from your good friends, Phoebe and Norval. P.S. I hope you like this new vacuum cleaner picture. It's the one I drew today. So guys, that was chapter 2 of The Mommy Wish by Pamela Browning. If you liked it, leave a comment down below what your favorite part was. Please like, comment, subscribe to this video. Hit the notification bell so you never miss a new video when I post. And I'll see you guys later.
Yeah.